Traveling by plane can be dangerous, as musicians know. The list of music luminaries who we've lost in plane crashes includes true icons, but also partial or entire bands who were victims of bad weather, pilot error, or simply cruel fate. Here are the plane crashes that nearly wiped out entire bands. In 1977, Lynyrd Skynyrd were riding high on the release of their fifth album, Street Survivors, as they departed on what was to be their biggest tour to date. Rather than using a tour bus, the band had chosen to charter a private plane, a Convair CV-240, operating out of Texas. According to history, the plane had been previously considered for this same use by Aerosmith, who had checked it out, but passed due to concerns about the crew. If they had made a different decision, we'd probably be writing about them. On October 20, 1977, Lynyrd Skynyrd's plane simply ran out of gas on its approach to Baton Rouge, Louisiana. The pilots, who would posthumously shoulder the blame for the crash, made a panicky request for an alternate landing site to Houston Air Traffic Control roughly 13 minutes before going down in a wooded area outside Gillsburg, Mississippi. Although 20 people survived the crash, it claimed the lives of lead singer Ronnie Van Zant, guitarist Steve Gaines, and his sister and backup singer Cassie Gaines. Although the band would eventually soldier on with Ronnie's brother Johnny taking over lead vocals, they wouldn't release another album until 1991. And they never again reached the stratospheric levels of success that they did before fate intervened. Reba McEntire has had one heck of an enviable career over four decades and nearly three dozen albums. She's one of the great stalwarts of country music, with hit record after hit record without ever changing up her traditionally influenced vocal style. She's also appeared in a ton of movies and TV shows, including her eponymous sitcom, which ran for six seasons between 2001 and 2007. But smack dab in the middle of it all, a plane crash claimed 8 of the 10 members of her backing band. As the star wrote in her 1994 autobiography, Reba, My Story, she was supposed to have been on the plane, but remained behind in Saginaw, Michigan after the night's gig due to a touch of bronchitis. A combination of the pilot's unfamiliarity with the area and the instructions an air traffic controller who told them that it was just fine to buzz a nearby mountain at under 3,000 feet resulted in the plane clipping an outcropping with its wing, sending it tumbling into rocky terrain where it exploded in a ball of fire. McEntire, of course, recovered professionally, but one never quite recovers personally from such a loss. Discussing the tragedy with Oprah Winfrey 20 years later, the Queen of Country broke down, saying,
"I don't guess it ever quits hurting."
Otis Redding was an absolute legend. His voice could make you dinner, give you some sweet romance, rock your infant child to sleep, and do the dishes. Memphis band The Bar Kays were approaching that status as well. And their 1967 tour with Redding was helping to cement it. One of their two surviving members, James Alexander, told WREG Memphis that it was, quote, "an amazing thing just to be mentioned in the same breath with him." Redding and the Bar Kays played over 100 shows together that year, one that should have ended in triumph, but instead ended in tragedy when their small plane, carrying Redding and every Bar Kays member except Alexander, crashed into a Wisconsin lake. Alexander rushed to the scene to be greeted by his shell-shocked bandmate Ben Cauley, the only survivor of the crash. Redding had just finished recording a rough version of what was to be his breakout crossover tune, which instead became the first posthumous number one pop hit in history, according to Best Classic Bands. Despite being a first draft, "Sittin' on the Dock of the Bay" is about as close to a perfect song as you can get. Cauley passed away in 2015. Alexander is still around, and he's the father of R&B producer Jazzy Faye, who he named after his bandmate Phelan Jones. En route to Zurich from Berlin in November 2001, Cross Air Flight 3597 encountered violent weather and went down in the woods. Of the 33 people on board, 24 perished, according to CNN. Somewhat lost in the shuffle was the fact that among them were up-and-coming singer Melanie Thornton and two of the three members of the Dutch-German dance pop outfit Passionfruit. The group, active since 1999, had scored hits in Germany with fun titles like The Rig-a-Ding-Dong Song, Sun Fun Baby, and Bongo Man. Sure, they may not have been the Beatles, but their fans loved them. Particularly shocking was the fact that it was Crossair's second fatal crash in only 2 years, and the airline ceased operations only a few months later, according to the Chicago Tribune. The cause of the crash was found to be pilot error, which you may recognize as a recurring theme here. In 2009, a commuter plane operated by small regional carrier Colgan Air experienced a mid-air stall. According to the experts from the National Transportation Safety Board, the pilot apparently then panicked, pulling back on the control column instead of pushing forward, not once, but three times. As a result, the plane tragically crashed into a house. Among the 49 lost were Jerry Niewood and Coleman Mellett, the saxophonist and guitarist respectively for the band headed by smooth jazz icon Chuck Mangione, whom you may know as a favorite of Peggy on King of the Hill.
That Chuck Mangione's one class act.
Mangione called the crash a horrible, heartbreaking tragedy, and it prompted a strenuous reevaluation of Colgan Air's training protocols. This didn't seem to help, however. About a year and a half later, according to Fox News, a Colgan flight en route to Lake Charles, Louisiana, landed at the wrong airport, resulting in action from the FAA. Colgan ceased operations less than a year later. Patsy Cline became a country music legend before even turning 30, but fate kinda seemed to have it in for her, and she seemed determined to tempt it. At 28, she was involved in a serious car crash, her second, which required months in the hospital and major facial reconstructive surgery to recover from. But that only slowed her down temporarily. She spent the next couple of years flying all over the place, countrying it up with fellow artists Cowboy Copas and Hawkshaw Hawkins, who had perhaps the two coolest names we've ever heard. A week before the plane crash that took the lives of all three, City Pages reports that she told a friend, "Honey, I've had two bad ones. The third one will either be a charm or it'll kill me." The third one came after performing a benefit concert in Kansas City. Fellow songstress Dottie West had a bad feeling about Cline flying and offered her a seat in her car for the return trip to Nashville. Cline, anxious to get home to her family, replied, "Don't worry about me, Hoss. When it's my time to go, it's my time." Unfortunately, those words proved prophetic. Once again, the inexperience of her small plane's pilot, who was her manager, Randy Hughes, proved to be the determining factor in the crash. Unbelievably, adding tragedy upon tragedy, fellow country artist Jack Anglin perished in a car crash on the way to Cline's funeral. Ricky Nelson was Justin Timberlake before Justin Timberlake was Justin Timberlake. He didn't just have an enviable career, he had several, and seemingly transitioned easily between them. He began his showbiz career as a child star on the classic sitcom The Adventures of Ozzie and Harriet, the stars of which were his real-life parents. At 16, he made his first album, and at 17, he scored his first number one single. At 19, he appeared in the classic western Rio Bravo, kicking off a long film and television career in his own right. The guy had pretty much conquered the world while still a teenager, so when he embarked on a comeback tour in his 40s, nobody had any reason to think he couldn't do it again. But on New Year's Eve 1985, tragedy struck when Nelson boarded an old Douglas DC-3 propeller plane with a history of mechanical problems. He and his Stone Canyon band had spent the better part of the year touring with Fats Domino, who was not on board the plane, and they were on their way to Dallas for another concert when the plane simply burst into flames in mid-flight, crashing into a pasture in Texas. Everyone aboard except the pilots were lost, including Nelson, his entire band, their sound guy, and Nelson's fiancée, Helen Blair. Jim Croce struggled for years to finally make it in the music world. He wrote his first hit song, You Don't Mess Around With Jim, in the cab of a truck he was driving to make ends meet. The New York coffee house circuit was where he finally found an audience receptive to his sound, which was partially shaped by his friend and guitarist, Maury Mulizen. His fourth album, Life and Times, gave him his first number one hit, Bad Bad Leroy Brown, and for a couple of years, the singer-songwriter was finally getting his due. He had just completed work on a fifth album, I Got a Name, when, on October 20, 1973, he and Mulizen, along with three others, lost their lives as their tiny, single-engine plane struck a tree while attempting to take off. Croce left behind not only his burgeoning career, but his wife, Ingrid, and a two-year-old son, AJ. Ingrid went on to become a successful restaurateur, while AJ followed in his dad's footsteps to become a respected singer-songwriter who carries his father's name with him. You may have heard of the day the music died, February 3, 1959. On that day, a small plane went down in bad weather, taking with it three absolute trailblazers of rock and roll. JP the Big Bopper Richardson, one of the first rockabilly stars, Richie Valens, the first Latino rock star, and Buddy Holly, whose mighty influence on the budding genre would continue to be felt for literally decades. The three had been on tour together, spreading the good work of rock throughout the land, and the crash that claimed their lives destroyed the innocence of teeny boppers far and wide. The plane had been chartered by Holly for himself and his band alone. Valens and Richardson, suffering from a touch of the flu, had actually talked their way onto the doomed craft, according to Rolling Stone. Valens persuaded guitarist Tommy Alsup to give up his seat, and Richardson asked the same of bassist Waylon Jennings, whom you may know went on to have a country-western career of some note. Jennings told Holly that he would just go ahead and take the bus to their next tour stop, to which Holly jokingly replied that he hoped the bus would break down. Jennings retorted, "I hope your old plane crashes." Of course, Jennings went on to become the leather-wearing bad boy outlaw of country, because if you inadvertently cursed one of the greatest musicians of all time, you'd break bad too. Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more grunge videos about your favorite bands are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.